On behalf of the AAVC board, we want to welcome all of the Board of Trustees to this joint dinner. It's wonderful to spend time with you. And it's wonderful to be here to honor our award recipient. So let me tell you a little bit about why we're here tonight. This honor that I'm about to bestow is called the Spirit of Vassar Award. The Spirit of Vassar Award is an honor that's given to someone who has demonstrated, extraordinary and distinguished leadership, contribution, and commitment to serving a community in which they have effected a positive transformational societal change. This contribution may have been made through the recipient's career, community, work, or volunteer service. The award recognizes the values of service and civic responsibility that are fundamental to a Vassar education and to the Vassar ethic. Listen closely and tell me if you can think of someone else who is more deserving of this award. As we all know, Vassar was founded on the very principle of equal opportunity. Professor Sherrilyn Ifill, class of 1984, has spent her entire career as one of the nation's foremost advocates fighting for that principle. After graduating from Vassar in 1984 and earning her law degree from the New York University School of Law, Professor Ifill served as a fellow at the American Civil Liberties Union, and then she became an assistant counsel at the New York office of the NAACP Legal Defense and Education Fund, Inc., also known as LDF. In 1993, she joined the faculty of the University of Maryland School of Law, and for the past 6 years, she served as the president and director-counsel of the NAACP Legal Defense Fund, thus cementing her position as one of the leading legal minds in the country on the subject of civil rights. She's the author of the book On the Courthouse Lawn, Confronting the Legacy of Lynching in the 21st Century, and she's played a pivotal role in the public discourse, engaging in and analyzing issues of race in American public life. That's just a summary of Sherrilyn Ifill's career to date. But her work has been so wide-ranging that one could go on for quite a long time exploring all of its many facets. I'd like to take special note of the fact that she has been outspoken about the importance of intersectionality, and she was long before that term became familiar to the public. And she's followed through with actions that underscore her commitment to that and other bold ideas. The range of subjects covered in her litigation, including amicus briefs filed by the LDF under her leadership, and in her writing and in her teaching, is breathtaking. They cover voting rights, environmental justice, both rural and urban communities, the rights of formerly incarcerated persons seeking to responsibly reenter society, transgender rights, inequality in the workplace, inequality in housing, the rights of immigrants, notably Haitians in America, affirmative action in higher education, parental rights, voter suppression, manipulation of the census. Professor Ifill has said that she discovered her passion for civil rights early in her life, having grown up in a politically minded family, and that as a child, she used to feel she'd missed the height of the civil rights movement. As it turns out, of course, there were and are all too many battles still to be fought, and even refought, and then refought. Professor Ifill is realistic about all of this work, having noted, no win comes easy, no win comes fast. And a key part of her formative years took place here at Vassar. In a wonderful commencement address to the class of 2016, aptly titled Passion, Professor Ifill told the graduating students, quote, a Vassar degree is a real degree, not just words on paper. And it's not just a degree. I'm sure that for you, as it was for me, there are so many other seeds that Vassar has planted in you that will bear unique and important and often very sweet fruit in your life. She went on, to cite a deep fondness for Greek tragedy that was nurtured here, a course with Professor Norman Hodges that marked the beginning of her commitment to and love for the country of South Africa, a life-changing trip to Yale with Professor Moses Nkondo to meet the great writer James Baldwin. Her participation in the Greenhaven Prison Program happened here, and she also met the love of her life, her husband Ivo Noblok. How'd I do? Ah! While she was in Madrid with the Vassar Wesleyan program there. I'll keep working on that. With the gift that Professor Ifill has communicating to people where they live, she also reminds students how much she treasured, quote, every moment spent in the extraordinary library, where no matter how hard I partied on Saturday night, I could be found all day Sunday. Before I conclude, I'd like to say a word or two about Ms. Ifill's scholarship. She is focused on the importance of diversity on the bench, and she's currently working on a book about race in the Supreme Court confirmation hearings. As director of the NAACP LDF, Professor Ifill follows in the footsteps of none other than Justice Thurgood Marshall. Do we need to say more about the inspiration she has already provided, or the future accomplishments that we stand behind and dream of her in conquering? Sherrilyn, you are the most modern of warriors, fighting for universal, timeless, and cherished ideals that we all have: democracy, equality, justice, civility, love. Vassar's pride in you and your continuing achievements is immense, my pride in you. But you've done all of this with an intelligence, devotion, and efficacy that is truly singular. I'd like to ask Sharon Davidson Chang, a fellow Vassar parent, a fellow member of your class of 1984, and chair of the AAVC Board Alumni Recognition Committee, to come forward and join me as we present you on behalf of the AAVC with the 2019 Spirit of Vassar Award.
Thank you, Stephen, and thank you, Sharon. That was just so beautiful, and I'm surprisingly feeling quite emotional. So I should say some stuff and then we'll do some questions? Is that what you said, or I should just say some stuff and sit down? No, it's helpful for me to know, because then I'll know whether I should go on or not. So I want to thank you all for this award. It means so much to me to be recognized in this way, and to be recognized by this institution. And I'm particularly grateful to Sharon for pursuing my crazy schedule to make sure that this could happen. And President Betsy, I thank you as well. It's really been lovely to meet you, and thank you for the warmth of your greeting. And Stephen, just to reconnect again, it's wonderful, and I so appreciate it. So I've had two talks today, and this feels like the wrong room in which to get very personal, but I'm gonna do it anyway. Because I think this is a very, very important and powerful moment in our country and in our lives as thinking people. And we're all being challenged in very important ways, and I think we need a little bit of transparency between us. Since November 2016 and the election, I've been doing a lot of public talks, and one of the reasons I've been doing them is because I'm firmly of the belief that we need to come out and see one another. And that it's very important for us to get past our virtual connections and to get real, to see one another and to believe that I'm sitting at a table having dinner with other people who believe in the humanity of people, that I'm sitting with other people who believe in justice, that I'm sitting with other people who believe in peace, that I'm sitting with other people who believe in love, that I share a core with those people about what life is all about. And for me, it's very powerful to sit in this room tonight and be having this conversation, because actually, I got married at Vassar, and this is the room where I had my reception. So when I'm here, I'm always thinking a lot about the people that I brought into this place. We basically brought out every room in the Alumni House, and so my family and my friends all came and we stayed for a weekend and we had an amazing celebration. This was a complete code switch for me when I came to Vassar in the fall of 1980. I'm a very nice, very ordinary black girl from Queens, and this was very new to me. I was not intimidated in many ways and intimidated in other ways. Intellectually, I didn't think I could be beat, and I wasn't. And I enjoyed being in a place where I felt that that could flourish. But this was a very new social environment for me. I didn't really understand it. And I had to figure out how to navigate myself here. As I shared earlier, part of what has always been true to me about Vassar was the physical environment was so beautiful to me. I just loved it. I loved every building. I loved the library. I just loved the idea that you could be in a place like this and that you could learn and I could allow that part of me to flourish. And I could also get seconds at dinner at ACDC, which was not something I had known of before, you know, outside of Thanksgiving. So there was a part of it that was really very beautiful. But I've had the opportunity to really think back on, you know, you think back on the things that make you, that make parts of you unshakable. Because I think that's what we need right now, is to figure out what parts of us are unshakable. Because there's so many things competing, and we're being compelled to answer questions about where we belong, who we belong with, what we believe, who will we follow. And in order to answer those questions, we have to decide, what is my core? Who am I? What do I believe? What things are unchangeable for me? And I talked about this a little bit this afternoon. I think that's the place where our country is failing. And I do believe that the places where we were trained, the institutions that we care about, are the places where we can reaffirm those things which are unshakable. So I will not ever believe that there are two sides to a Nazi rally. I will not believe that there's another side to separating 15-month-old children from their parents. I won't ever believe that we should think it's okay to enact laws that try to keep people from voting. We might disagree about who they should vote for, but I'm not ever gonna believe that we shouldn't want everyone to participate fully in the political process. And deciding what we believe, deciding what that core is the stuff that gets developed, in my view, partially in the education system, in places like Vassar, and in places like my high school, a sprawling, huge public high school in New York City that was bigger than Vassar. And what I can remember from my senior central course in Great Books, which was our AP English course, where I first was introduced to the Greek classics, was I remember writing a paper about Medea and why Medea was, the paper I wrote was that Medea was justified in killing her children. Now wait, don't call the authorities. And I do think my teacher was a little alarmed, but the paper was about a woman who believed that she had the same right to honor as a Greek man, and what it meant to her to have been betrayed in the circumstances that she was in, where she had given up everything for Jason. And I had a teacher who could understand what I was writing in that paper. I think I had also written that Clytemnestra was justified in killing Agamemnon. So there was a theme. But the point is that I truly believe that my grappling with Medea had a lifelong effect on my ability to do the work that I do. We represented LDF people on death row. Some of whom claim their innocence, but some of whom have done terrible things. And we still believe that they are entitled to be tried and sentenced in a justice system that's free from racial discrimination. And so we represent those people because we believe in a system. And I truly believe that those opportunities to see some, to read about someone doing terrible things, but to understand their motivation, to think about them. We do this all the time in our capital cases. We just did one in Arkansas and argued a case in the Arkansas Supreme Court. And to understand what who this young man was and what happened to him in his childhood that led him to do the terrible thing that he was involved in, helped us figure out how to write that. And those things are in me. And being here at Vassar, what I developed in this space also helped me do this important work. It helped me think about what I believe about America, what I believe was possible, what I believed was true about people, no matter what their background was, no matter what their race was. It allowed me to engage with people with whom I disagreed and to be able to have a good time with them when we weren't talking about politics, to see their humanity. This was a powerful place to develop those things. And those are the things that allowed me then to go on in my career and to be able to litigate cases in the South against opponents who I, you know, vehemently disagreed with, but who I didn't feel the need to denigrate personally and who I understood were playing their role in our justice system and who I liked when they were doing their role well. I liked when they were doing it well and I liked when I was doing it well. There are ways in which these institutions are so vital to us to help us be able to shape the idea of what it means to be a citizen in a democracy. And I think in this country at this moment, we have lost our way. And I would be remiss standing before you if I didn't say the truth that we have lost our way. I also do not know that we come out of this okay. I do not think it is inevitable that we do. I think that we will. I'm an optimist. But I think that we will because I think that there are so many people, like people in this room, who are committed to the idea of fighting for a democracy. And I guess what I want to say to you tonight is that it will not happen with our passive acquiescence. We will have to speak. We will have to say what the truth is. We will have to fight. We will have to acknowledge that none of us are in this room because of chance. We're in this room because of decisions that were made by people who came before us to fight for something that maybe they couldn't see. I was sharing earlier today that working where I work at the LDF, an organization created in 1940 essentially by a group of black lawyers who decided to fight for equality under the Constitution and to fight, they believed that they could what Thurgood Marshall called break the back of Jim Crow. And they believed it not because there was a blueprint, not because anybody had done it before, not because they were modeling themselves on some other country that existed. They literally made it up themselves and believed that they could make the words of the Constitution real and true. That kind of courage, that kind of vision, that kind of boldness is what is required in this moment when we're facing the challenge that we're facing. And I do worry that we have gotten a little soft. Some of us think we're self-made. None of us are self-made. And we forget the struggles that it took to make this room look like this room. Didn't happen because that's just the way the world goes. It happened because people were willing to fight. So for my own part, I'm the youngest of 10 children, raised in Queens. I went to a high school not far from where Donald Trump grew up, Hillcrest High School, the most diverse place I've ever been, with the exception of LDF. And everything that I was able to do came out of what was then, for a period in the United States, a commitment to public life. And that commitment to public life took a variety of forms. It meant that I, as a kid in Queens, in high school, could, with one token, which at that point was 35 cents, take it and go to a job in Harlem and make money. It was a commitment to public life that meant that my school was a good school. The teacher that I'm telling you about, who passed away 2 years after I came to Vassar, actually, I will tell you that the first year I came to Vassar, they would ask you in the first month to write about the teacher that influenced you the most, and you would write it, and then they would send it back to your high school teacher. And I wrote about this teacher, Lenore Van Ora. And they sent it back to her. I did not know she was dying of cancer at the time, but she was. And later, other professors told me about it. And I wrote about this experience of having a teacher who let me write about Medea being justified in killing her children. She was exceptional, and there were many of them in New York City at the time, teachers who could have been professors at colleges, but who were teaching in high school and who were extraordinary in these very diverse, big, sprawling schools. But we had a commitment at that point to public education in a way that perhaps we don't today. There were people who fought civil rights battles who made my life possible. I was sharing earlier today that, you know, when I was accepted to Vassar, the tuition, I think, was $10,000, Sharon. Does that sound right? Something like that. And you got a worksheet that explained how you were going to pay for the $10,000. I mean, I told you I'm the youngest of 10 children, so it's a worksheet. And the worksheet had it all. So the scholarship was like $6,000. Awesome, right? You think you're going, right? So it's like $4,000 they had to figure out. And there were loans, and then there was like a parent contribution section. And the parent contribution section, I think, was $1,100. And so I was very clear, we were not going because we don't have $1,100. And so we worked it out and we had to do this loan. But the person who signed the promissory note for my loan was not my father, was not my stepmother, it was my brother. And my brother could sign the promissory note because he owned a rather nice home in Floral Park, Queens, which he was able to purchase because of litigation that organizations like LDF had done to open up the electrical union, the Local 3, to admit him. And he had been an electrician and was till he retired at age 65 and moved to Myrtle Beach. He's the only person in our family who has any money. And but he was a hardworking electrician his whole life and was able to make it into the union, and he was able to purchase this home. And he could sign the promissory note that allowed me to come to this institution. All along the way were these investments in our public life. And if there's one thing I think we have lost in this country, it is that. We have turned that which is public into something to be scorned, and we have elevated the private. Public education, public transportation, public schools. We don't even want to have public prisons. We want to have private prisons. But it is vital that we reinvest in the idea of public life, that we understand the value of public life, and that we understand that those are the building blocks that then brings people to this institution, like this wonderful young man who's going to be a biology professor at Vassar one day, that brings together people who otherwise would not know each other and who would be disconnected, and provides the opportunity for me to meet my amazing husband, for example, and provides the opportunity for me then 32 years later to be standing here in front of all of you in this room, where I experience what is literally still the happiest day of my life. So I feel very optimistic about the possibility of this country, but not optimistic in the sense that I think it's inevitable. And I guess I want to encourage all of you, particularly those who are in institutions of higher learning, which I think is a very difficult job at this point. I think it's incredibly difficult. There are so many competing interests, so many demands about every word you say, about how you do everything. There's just so much pressure. I know that this is real. But I really believe these are the places where the building blocks of the kind of public life that we need and the kind of citizenry that we need are being created. And that citizenry is a citizenry that can recognize the humanity in one another and that can make a commitment to the humanity of every person in this room. If you can't do that, we're not going to make it. I can just tell you that that's where we are. And Stephen mentioned, you know, a book that I wrote in 2007 about lynching, about the last two recorded lynchings in Maryland. And I wrote this book in part because I kept running into stories about lynching in my civil rights work, but also because I wanted to understand how normal, average people could become embroiled in these very horrific events. And in my research, I learned that they were average people and that we should not fool ourselves into thinking that the people who participated in or witnessed horrific events around the world, whether it was the Holocaust, whether it was the genocide in Rwanda, whether it was in Cambodia, whether it was the Japanese internment, whether it was slavery or whether it was Jim Crow, to stop thinking of them as extraordinary people, as excessive people, to release ourselves from the idea that it was people with big stomachs and big hats, and it was normal, average people like you and me. And there is a pathway to that. And I think in this country, we're on that pathway, and we better get off really fast. I know you don't think it can happen, but I know that it can. In my book, I document the role of housewives and pharmacists and law students and the high school football team, and who all stood around to watch the killing, the public killing of black men on a Saturday, and then went to church on Sunday. And so I believe when we begin to release ourselves from this idea that we are all human beings entitled to a certain core set of protections, that we set ourselves on that path. And I want to encourage all of us to see this moment as the perilous moment that it is, that this is a moment that requires your best self. Whatever made you feel like your best self is required at this moment. And it's required that you share that best self with your family, with your colleagues, with the people in your neighborhood, and that we pull ourselves back from the precipice. So much went into fighting to make this country be what it has been, which has not been perfect. But it's created rooms like this that didn't exist and wouldn't have existed but for the fight and the battle of so many people. So I want to encourage you to, even if it feels incredibly hard, to know that the stakes are incredibly high at this moment. And you will have to answer the question 20 or 30 years from now, what did you do? You will have to answer that question. You will not be able to offload it into a discussion about how terrible someone else was. You will have to answer, what did you do? And so I hope that all of you will feel in your own way, in your own space, wherever you can do it, the call to be our best selves, to respond to the privilege of having been nurtured in a space like this, and to use the tools that we were given by virtue of having been in this space to demand that our country be better, to demand that our country be what it can be, to not believe that you're going to somehow make it out and so it's going to be all right, and to reaffirm what liberal arts is all about, which is about learning about the humanity of our shared selves, and to use whatever tools you've been given in your work, in your profession, whatever success you've been able to achieve, to not own it for yourself, but to share it with the project of democracy, to see that as your role as a citizen, as I do. So I thank you for this acknowledgement tonight, and thank you for the opportunity to be here. Thank you for the opportunity to share with you a sense of purpose. I don't know what your individual professions are. It doesn't matter. There is a way you can make a difference. There is a way. And you have to decide that you want to do it. You have to believe that it's that important. So I want to encourage you to do that, and thank you for all that you do for this institution and for keeping this institution as a place where young people can learn and grow and be safe for a minute just to develop themselves, develop their minds, develop their spirits, develop their hearts, develop friendships. So important. So thank you.